Alright, so today I want to talk about the fundamental theorem of calculus. It's so important that people just call it the fundamental theorem of calculus. By the way, there's a fundamental theorem of algebra. Does anyone know what that is? It's like, if you have fifth order polynomial, then it must have five zeros, five roots. If you take account of all the complex solutions and also the multiplicities. That's what fundamental theorem of algebra is. Like, nth order polynomial must have n roots. That's the statement. Fundamental theorem of calculus is what I'm about to introduce to you, and I'm just going to call it version 0.9 for the moment, because it's like a version I want to introduce before actually introducing you to the actual fundamental theorem of calculus. I'm going to also put version 1 pretty soon. Okay, so all right. So let's say you have a function f of x whose graph is something like this. And I want to define this area function S of x in the following way. It's a function whose value is the area under the graph from 0 to x. Okay. So it's the area under the graph over 0 to x. Okay. To understand what it means, let me ask a few questions. So assume that f of x is always positive, so it's always like that. Now, if you were to compare the value of s of 1 versus s of 2, which is bigger? So here's a graph of f, it's positive. Let's just say this is 1 and this is 2, right? So what's S of 1? This area, right? What's S of 2? Which is bigger? S of 2, right? Okay. So in the case when the function is positive, then the more further you go right, the bigger S will become. Agreed? Okay. So if you understood that, then you kind of understood what S of X is. Okay? That's what I mean by S of X. Now let me ask you another question. What is S of 0?
Zero.
Why is that?
Because you have no interval to go through.
Right. So if I am asking S of 0, that's 0 to 0. So basically, you're asking for the area over 0 to 0, which is just this. What's the area of a line? 0. Lines don't have any areas. It's a 0 area. So S of 0 is 0. All right. So this is what S of x is. And once you understood what this function is, then I'm ready to tell you what the statement of the fundamental theorem of calculus version 0.9 is. The fundamental theorem of calculus version 0.9 states that if you take that function and you differentiate it, you get the function f of x, this function. In other words, S of x is the antiderivative of the fx. That's the statement. Now, why is that? To explain why that is, I'm going to give you several different arguments, but not the mathematical proof. You can actually prove this mathematically, but it takes too long, and also If it's enlightening, if you understood something more from that proof, I would do the proof, but I don't think it's that it makes your intuition any better than just showing you these different arguments for it. Okay? So first argument I want to make is somewhat really rough one, and it's like this. Think about your function where your function is like very big, and then at some point it becomes really, really, really small. Now, you guys learned that the derivative has two meanings. One is the slope of the tangent, and the second meaning is the rate of change of that thing with respect to the variable that you change, okay? And it's easier to understand this equation when you think about this left side as the rate of change of this quantity, okay? What's the rate of change of Sx when you're, so in here, let's think about the rate of change of Sx. And you can also think about the rate of change of Sx here. Now, which one's bigger?
Right, the second one.
Oh, no. The S itself is bigger here. Okay, but the rate of change, look at this. When you say rate of change, it's really doing this. If you increase your x slightly, how fast is your capital S increasing? Okay. So it's really a comparison between how much you're gaining when you're you increase slightly here and when you increase slightly here. So if your F value is small, what's happening to your area? As you're going right, is it increasing quickly? No, it's not increasing quickly. So over here, if you were to draw the graph of S of X, you'll see that the graph is increasing very slowly. And even in the extreme case when it's actually zero, then your S of X will be nothing. It'll just be constant, because there's no area gained as you move right. But if you get to a point where it's huge, right, then, let's say it's huge like this, then just slightly increasing your x increases the s by a lot, right? So from this, you kind of see that s of x is this, the derivative of this thing is proportional to the f of x. When f of x is big, the rate of change will be big. If f of x is small, close to zero, then s of x rate of change will be small. We're talking about the rate of change here. I'm not talking about the value of S of X. I'm talking about how fast is it increasing. And if you compare this statement to that statement, the surprising thing that this is claiming is that not only is proportional, it's actually equal. All right. So this is like a rough idea, right? Now, to actually give you a better argument, we have to think about this picture in a more careful way. So the second argument I want to give for this is the following. If you're here at x, and let's just say that you're increasing x by some small quantity dx. Dx is a very small quantity, right? Then your area will also increase, right? So this much will be the how much S increases. So I want to see what's the relation between how much S has increased when you increased X. What's the relationship between them? Now, what is this value here? What's the length of that? How do you get that length? Over x. Yes?
You plug in your x value to the function.
Yes. You just plug in your x value into the function, and the function itself is f of x. So if you plug in x into here, that means this side is f of x. Right? You can also, this is x plus dx, so this side will be f of x plus dx. That's also true. So I know that this side is f of x. But then, we're going to assume that this dx is very, very small, so thin that it's almost like a strip, and you don't really see difference between the left and right. It's like almost the same value, okay? In that case, you can just think of this strip as a rectangle, right? Whose base length is dx, whose height is f of x. The height will be f of x. So we have ds equal to f of x times dx. Then you divide both sides by dx, and guess what you get? You get ds over dx equals to f of x. And I hope everyone knows that this is just another symbol for the derivative. It's the Leibniz notation for the derivative. This is the Newton's notation for the derivative. This one here has a better way of talking about the derivative, because it asks how much does s increase relative to the increase in x. That's what this left side means. Okay, and we just found out that relative increase is the function f(x) itself, which is this statement. Okay? All right, so that's the fundamental theorem of calculus, version 0.9. Was that easy to understand? Okay, now let me give you the third argument. And this is actually probably what Newton was thinking. See, the first person to realize this was Newton. And Newton was a physicist. So he was thinking about everything in the context of physics, where you have like moving things. So if you had the velocity and time, and you had some curve, then, oh, I should do an easy example first. So if you had like 50 miles per hour, and you had time t, and this was like 2 hours here, and you went at a constant speed, 50 miles per hour, and you do 50 miles per hour times 2 hours, what do you get? You get 100 mile, which is a distance traveled. Right? So Newton realized that in the graph of the velocity and time, the area under the graph has the meaning of the distance traveled. So he thought about this function s of t from 0 to t, right, for v, and then thought about what's the relationship between this distance traveled and the speed v, e of t. How do you get, well, this is always positive, and s is always increasing, so for this case, I can just interchange the two meanings, distance and position, and also speed and velocity means the same thing in this one-dimensional case where the velocity is always positive. So I'm really saying this is like the position that the particle is in, right? And this is the speed. That's the velocity. What's the relationship between position and velocity? Yeah?
It's directly proportional. So when velocity increases.
No, we learned this last semester. We learned that if you take the derivative of the position, you get
velocity.
And then you take the derivative of velocity, you get acceleration, right? So he already knew that. And because he already knew that, he knew that, oh, so the area under the curve, if you define this function and differentiate, you get the velocity. That's what Newton found out. Okay. All right. So that's probably good enough for you to believe what that is, right? Okay. Now, let me show you the version 1, or fundamental theorem of calculus 1. That's what it's called. So the real version says the following. If you have a function over the interval a to b, and if I call this I'll just call this as area right now, okay? Area A, then we know that this area would be S at B and then S at A. Why is that? Well, S at B is 0 to B, so it's this much. That's this much is S evaluated at B. And this much is S evaluated at A, right? This area here. So if you have this much minus this area, what are you left with? This one. Okay? So here's how you're supposed to find the area under the curve over A to B. Remember that S was the antiderivative, right? So to find the area under the curve, you have to find the antiderivative of that function and evaluate at the two points that you subtract. That's the statement of the fundamental theorem calculus. And it goes like this. You have, first you write this area in the following way: A to B of f of x dx. It's a rather cryptic way of writing the area, but there's a reason why they use this symbol, because you use this one because it's related to the antiderivative, right? You use A and B because those are the endpoints. And you use fx times dx. That I'm going to elaborate a little bit later. But there's a reason why you use this one, this complicated notation for this area, right? And the fundamental theorem of calculus says you have to find the antiderivative of small f of x and evaluate it at two different points and you subtract, and that's what you get. So since s is just one of the antiderivatives, it just turns out that even if you have other antiderivatives, not just s, s is a special one where it satisfies s of 0 equal to 0, right? But that's not necessary. That's not a condition we need. You can actually use any kind of antiderivative, and this will give you the same value. And that is the statement of the fundamental